on the unit interval. Instead, the dxy Bessel equal dxz dzy is some kind of operation instead of plus. Okay. And the interpretation of f xy of t is very nice, namely for a fixed d, f we will see complete f xy of t is that means the probability that the distance between x and y is less than t. It is an extra parameter t, not a number d of xy. Only we know only the probability that two points be closed. Okay. And here are some books and monographs about the probabilistic spaces. You use mostly the paper of the book of Hajici and Pak. This is about the fixed point theory in probabilistic magnetic spaces, and also the first book on probabilistic magnetic spaces by Schweizer and Sklar, this one. Schweizer and Sklar. And other books to Cho and Kang, Cho, Rabies and Radu. And actually, I think that one was the first book in probabilistic spaces about the probabilistic spaces, but it is in Romania. It is in 1974, and the book of Reiser and Sklar is in 1979. And now, in the definition of probabilistic magnetic spaces, for the definition of probabilistic magnetic spaces, we need first to define the notion of distribution function. In fact, the notion of distance distribution function. The distribution function is a mapping for the extended reals with values in the unit interval, which is less continuous, non-decreasing, and such that f of minus infinity equals 0 and f plus infinity equals 1. Please note that domain is the extended reals. Okay? Extended reals. And the distance distribution function satisfies the supplementary condition to be 0 in 0. Okay? This one is a distance distribution function. It is defined on R0. Actually, this part is not interesting for now, because the function being non-decreasing and 0, 0, 0, it is 0 of all, it is 0 on the left of 0. And this left continuous is always close here in the right. This one. This is an example of distribution factor. Other examples are as follows. Quite important special distribution function is the function epsilon 0 defined by epsilon 0 of t called 0 for t up to 0 and 1 for t epsilon 0 since that function. Zero. Okay. A special function. Okay. And other two important examples: the generalization, or more general, is the unit step a is zero up to a and zero. And one is epsilon A.
So if you go upwards and you
go. Okay. Subclass of B class is the class of functions which are continuous at infinity. That means the property mean the class of such functions will be denoted by B class. Okay? Here is a definition of the class. The class. Okay. All the functions here are in D class. Okay. Remember that the value in infinity is 1. Why is that I set this continuous at infinity. Okay. This is enough for the notion of distance distribution function. The function d plus and delta plus and d plus. Okay, very important this we will see what important this condition will be. Okay. The other notion is the definition of cohesive spaces, and also is the notion of triangular. Shortly T naught. Okay. Yes.
What do you mean by have weak convergence?
Weak convergence means
because we don't have any normal space or like
that. This means fn of t converges to fdt, converges to fdt at every continuity point.
Means it's with respect to weak topology or something?
Yes, weak. It is a weak. This means weak topology. Okay? Converges weak. This is a definition. Okay? This is just definition of the weak convergence of a sequence of distribution functions. This is generally the definition from the probability theory. Okay. About triangular knots. The notion was introduced by Menger, of course. They can be found not only in the definition of probabilistic metric space, but in each argument, in fact, it is in each argument, and a very important condition of associativity, which has been given later in 1960 by Schweitzer and Sklar. In fact, in the definition of Menger, there are weaker conditions. Tn4 is absent here, and here is no proper neutral element, but only to satisfy T or one equals one. It is not important. Or anyway, you look with the definition of T norm in the sense of this definition of Schweitzer and Sklar. Okay? Remember these four axioms of a T-norm. Important examples. The T-norm mean defined by Tm minimum between I and B. So the T-norm Tm, it's very important T-norm. Another important norm is T-norm P product. I think I pronounce correctly product. Product. Okay. And other very, very important, Munkashevich. It is written something like but the pronunciation is Ukashevich. Ukashevich. A friend of mine, Polish, told me that the correct pronunciation is Ukashevich.
Ukashevich.
Yes,
Ukashevich.
This is the definition. Maximum between A plus B minus 1 and 0. Why this maximum? Why not some simple A plus B minus 1? Why not? Why not?
Because when you put negative,
it has only positive values.
Yes.
Okay. This is, and there is other denon, the plastic product, which is zero almost everywhere. This is the definition. Of course, when A or B is 1, the values is B and Y respectively, because 1 is a neutral element. And here is this zero. This is the drastic product. Okay? Four important examples of t-norms. I put some other examples to be here. I can't remember all of the definitions. I have to know that class, general Weber class, contains TD, TP, and TL, Ukashevich T-norm. For some, this is a family, it depends of lambda. For lambda, for example, for lambda equals 0, here is the Ukashevich T-norm. T0 is SV, is Ukashevich T-norm. You can compare two t-norms by point-wise ordering. This means that t1 is less of t2 if, for definition, it is less than t2 in every pair of points. And with this relation, we can order the t-norms, and it's important that tm, the minimum t-norm, is the strongest. So,
there is the order holding. You write on t less than tm, less than tp, and less than tm. What is the basis that we choose a particular pair of points?
No, for every. For all. Okay? Means for all. For all x and y in points. Okay? And it is important. Tm is the strongest t-norm. Tm is the strongest t-norm. And this relation is very important. Ukashevich t-norm is less than 1, is the length of the TP in this order. Okay? Of course, TP is the weakest t-norm. And please note the first exercise to prove that TL is indeed a t-norm. Please note, this is for the next tutorial. Prove that TM is a t-norm, and prove that TM is the strongest t-norm, and that TL is, and that TM is the strongest t-norm. Okay, the first exercise. is not easy, it's not very complicated, but it's not quite easy. To prove that here is indeed a p-norm. Expand the p-norm by any operation. Imagine that notation generally does not have any meaning, because binary operations allows to operate only with pairs, because x may be x plus y for this pair, and then or x plus, you can combine in different ways, considering the elements in this order, x, y, z. Okay, A, the associativity allows us to define such an operation, and similarly for a t-norm, for any t-norm, by definition, A, T of x1, x2, xn is defined as in algebra recurrently by T. When n is zero, it's by definition one, and p, say, is p of this is a definition borrowed from algebra, from abstract algebra. It's very important to have such, because if you have associativity, you have something like this, and you have also the powers of an element. This is x, n of, so on. This is very important. You can formulate properties similar with a metric in the fixed point theory. What means x n? And here, as a property, and another, of course, if you take here the limit when tends to infinity, then this by definition is the definition of here you take limit on n tends to infinity. Okay. Please. Yes. Okay, this is a definition of a p-norm. Some fundamental examples. Let's go further. Is it correct? Let's go further.
Yes.
Further. Some special graces classes of the norms. Very important, especially you talk about the p-norms of Hodge type. Here I want to achieve the definition of the p-norm of Hodge type. Okay. Very important in the fixed point theory of Fabry-Simplicity spaces. First, the first definition is the definition of Archimedean of, sorry, the notion of continuity. The continuity of a t-norm is defined in the natural way, namely t is continuous, it is continuous in the product topology. Remember that t is making from I squared to I, 0, 1 squared to 0, 1, and if this mapping is continuous in the product topology, then it is said that T is continuous. But an interesting fact, that if T is continuous only in one argument, then it is continuous. Very interesting. It is not generally true, but due to associativity and monotonicity, this result can be proved. Okay, it is sufficient to show it is continuous in one of the arguments. Now, the definition of an Archimedean t-norm. A t-norm, t is called Archimedean, it is satisfies this condition. For every x and y, there is n, natural n, such that t of n, t of x, less than y. Imagine that you are the product. This is 0, 1, and y is given. There is n such that therefore, the t-norm product is an Archimedean t-norm. Here, we call that y is 0, 1. Okay. The t-norm product is an Archimedean t-norm. Okay. According to this definition. Characterization of continuous Archimedean t-norms. Namely, a continuous Archimedean t-norm, is Archimedean if it satisfies this inequality for each x in 0, 1. This is the important part of this proposition. If a continuous t-norm satisfies t of xx strictly less than x, then it is Archimedean. And please note the next exercise. Exercise to show to prove proposition 2.
You can announce or you can note that these exercises, so we will discuss the things in
yes,
the classes.
We will discuss
so
these exercises
and it will be
a tutorial.
There will be a session on the tutorial, so
Please try first to solve. Okay,
so write down all the exercises.
Okay. They are not mandatory, but we'll discuss. Tutorial, and it will be much easier for you to. Can you follow my speech? Is it okay? For another characterization of an intermediate neuron, you need the notion of the quasi inverse, pseudo inverse of pairing. And you basically only to continuous mappings, and the definition is the issue. Zero. Okay. have the philosophy to define only on 0, 1. And here, being decreasing, still decreasing, here is, she has negative values. And for pseudo inverse, we have here is 0. Okay? This is the definition of pseudo inverse. Okay? Please note that as a exercise. No, not yet. Later. And there is a nice theorem characterizing Archimedean, continuous Archimedean d-norms. Theorem 3.3. Please look at the second part of the theorem. For any continuous Archimedean d-norm, there exists a function like this, f. This means this is this continuous decreasing, steady decreasing, with f of 1, 0, such that t, where t is defined by t. Plus, or the unity. This is in fact an Archimedean d-norm, a continuous Archimedean d-norm, and such a function f is called the additive generator of t. Okay. Therefore, Kukashevich t-norm is an Archimedean t-norm. It's not necessary to prove it, because if you prove that f of x is an additive generator for t, from this theorem it follows that it is Archimedean. Although the proof that TL is Archimedean is very very easy. Archimedean d-norms are important. They are very important because any continuous d-norm can be expressed by means of Archimedean T norms and the T norm Tn, meaning T norm, the very, very important result. Here, theorem V4. I will write this theorem here on the table to explain. But what the ordinal sum of such summons means? I think it's better to be from the screen. Capital K is the most countable index set. It's like the set of natural numbers, the set of rational numbers, etc. T kappa, Tk, is in Romanian, this is kappa. Tk is a family of T norm, of T norms. Okay. And Pk is a linear transform, a linear mapping defined by for T Ak Bk, and of course you have a family of open intervals Ak and is disjoint. There are, therefore, a family of T norms, a family of disjoint intervals, open disjoint intervals, and this mapping, how operated this mapping? It will transform the interval AK, BK in 0, 1, linearly. In 0, when T, AK, BK is. And the theorem, the representation theorem of a continuous T-norm asserts that this mapping defined by F, the inverse of Fk, Tk of Fk of A, Fk of B, if AB is in the if A is AB are in ATBK, and the mean of AB otherwise is a T norm. Okay, let's start. We'll write this here by TAB. Equals A T K plus A B. Otherwise, I write here directly the inverse of phi, of phi. In Romanian, this is phi, not phi. Yeah, sorry, I have pronounced phi almost everywhere. Okay. This is a pinon. And of course, it has a special denomination. It has a special name. It is called the ordinal sum of summands. This is AK, BK, BK, not alpha and beta. Okay? This is of summands AK, BK, BK, DK. Like this. This is the notation for this denote. Important part of this theorem is the second part, which says that conversely, every continuous pinon is an ordinal sum of important of continuous Archimedean summands. Therefore, for every continuous pinon, you can find a class of continuous Archimedean pinons such that P be expressed like this. Okay? Every continuous pinon is something like this. Or for suitable choose of TK. This is a theorem of Ring about 1960. Ring's presentation theorem. And finally, the definition. A pinon of Hardish type. How much time?
35 minutes.
Here's a definition 3-3. A pinon P is said to be of Hardish type. The class of this denotes by calligraph H. If the family of it iterates, if they continuous at X equals 1, and there is the better. This is in fact this explanation of this definition. For every epsilon positive, that is delta in 0-1, such that T and for every n, this is also the good definition, but it may have it for all x greater than 1 and for all n. It was sufficient to put there 1 minus the delta, because t is increasing. This was good at the initial definition. But this is a definition. T of n for all x and for all n. Okay? For some delta and for every epsilon. Okay? This is the definition of a T norm of Hartree type. And here is a very nice characterization of a continuous T norm of Hartree type. Continuous. Namely, if you have the representation of T as a continuous T norm, as you know that every continuous T norm is an ordinal sum of continuous Archimedean T norms. T is a T norm of Hartree type if and only if in this representation given by the families either the is less than 1 or this is the characterization of continuous T-norm of Hartree type. If you consider the representation of T, and you have sub of bk less than 1 or supremum of ak equals 1, then T is here instead.
Which one is correct? Minimum or supremum?
This is supremum.
And this infimum bk?
Also supremum. Infimum of bn is b1. Yeah. Now we consider the increasing. Okay. This is the definition of, this is a characterization of a T-norm of Hartree type. Okay. And this theorem, you have here the proof. You can try to, this is not very difficult, but you have to know the definition of infimum and supremum. Please remember this definition of infimum and supremum, because we'll work a lot of these notions. Okay. And here, this result appeared in this form in a paper in Journal of Mathematical Analysis and Application about uh, Okay, you have the references. And here is an example, the first example of a T-norm of Hartsteig. Based on this theorem, and maybe choosing for the interval the supremum of alpha k is 1. This is an example this is an example of a continuous T-norm of Hartsteig different from minimum. Because the minimum of the OC is the T-norm minimum is of the OC a T-norm of Hartsteig. It's important to find the T-norms of Hartsteig different from minimum. Okay. And here is another nice characterization of continuous T-norms of Hartsteig due to Radu. Professor Radu was my mentor. A very nice characterization and very simple to detail. A T-norm is a continuous T-norm is of Hartsteig if he has a strictly increasing sequence of idempotents tending to 1. This theorem Mayliss says. A continuous T-norm is of Hartsteig if and only if there is a strictly increasing sequence Bn converging to 1, such that T of Bn and Bn equals Bn. That is, Bn is idempotent for T. Okay. This is. And if you want to please prove theorem for home, that's the characterization of T-norm Hartsteig. Important. For every B, you can find an idempotent greater than B. This is. Without of course, C in 0, 1. This is very nice characterization. This is a T-norm. If T is a Hartsteig, then for all A, you can find an idempotent greater than A. And of course, T is not a Hartsteig if starting with an idempotent, it is Archimedean. This is the characteristic of T-norm, which is not a continuous, which is not a Hartsteig. This is very simple to recognize if a continuous T-norm is or not. Or it is not of Hartsteig. And what following this example, proposition, so to say. Okay. Finally, another important class of T-norm is the T-norm of geometrically convergent, the class of geometrically convergent T-norms. is defined in the definition before. It is like something like this. Like this. This means a geometrically convergent DR. This is when we work with the concrete DR, it is pretty quite simple. Examples of geometrically convergent. Remember that Lukács T-norm is a geometrically convergent. Okay, Lukács T-norm is geometrically convergent. Where have you? Have you met such a condition? When you prove that the sequence is Cauchy, something similar, something similar. We here will be x and x prime, something about the Cauchy-ness condition. And finally, the definition of probabilistic metric space. The basic references of this lecture is a book of Hydrogen Park. And of course, some results from a monograph of Radu and the book of Schreiser and Sklar. They are not my results, they are the basic notions for definition of probabilistic metric space. Okay. Probabilistic space is a triple. X is a non-empty set. F is a mapping from X times X to delta plus. Remember the definition of delta plus: distance distribution functions. And you will denote f of xy. This is a distribution function. Will be denoted by f xy. This you avoid the double brackets here and you put x, y up, okay? Okay, therefore, fxy is a distribution function. Yes, fxy for every xy in x. Distribution function. And t is a t naught. Now, you already know all these notions. Okay? And to be a Poincaré space, the following four axioms have to be satisfied. The first two are a kind of separability conditions, as in the case of metric space, namely F is our special distribution function, epsilon 0. This is in metric spaces, what, yeah? The analog. Okay. The second one is a separability axiom, maybe x. Then xy is not epsilon 0. Usually, these conditions are expressed in terms of a single one, namely f xy is a if and only if it equals y. Okay? This is the separability condition. The second one is the symmetry. Or maybe more correctly is to put it as a pairs, because F is defined but it's correctly the same. Okay? And the type inequality, the invention of Menger. Instead, this inequality in the definition of PM space, this entity is expressed by terms of P. Everything is similar, but here is P instead plus. And of course, the inequality is reversed. Is reversed. Why? Because you to have in mind the interpretation of F. This means that the probability of tables is greater than the probability then. Not if we are interested the probability to be greater than, closer to one. Not probability to be great. Why is that? This is just interpretation, but it is easy to remember. Generally, the inequalities in probability are greater than. Okay? The axiom, the triangle inequality for probabilistic metric spaces, okay? And another expression of, you say that X, F is a probabilistic metric spaces under T. Or that it is the same with saying that X, the triple is probabilistic metric space. No. Okay? What is to be remembered? The values of F are this here classes. Okay, these are distribution functions. Naturally, what happens when here is D plus instead delta plus? Remember, D plus, for D plus, we have limit to infinity equals 1. Okay? Such spaces have a special name due to namely, they call Menger probabilistic metric spaces, and you find Menger as a definition. Immediately, you think that here is D plus, not D plus. Okay, and this and sometimes instead. Probabilistic metric spaces, to emphasize that the values are in delta plus, you say generalized probabilistic metric spaces. In generalized metric spaces, the values of capital F are distance distribution functions. Okay? Some examples. And an interesting observation is if XF is a PM space under T, under T, then it is also a PM space under any Weber denote. This is important. We will take advantage of this observation sometimes. The first examples goes from probabilistic the probability theory. In fact, I think that there was the starting point of the definition of Menger, but I'm not quite sure. But Professor Radu told me. Something similar, but I'm not quite sure. And please, the example for this boy I write here is a why is it important this example. Called induced PM space. This example is very important because it says that every metric space can be viewed as a Menger, probabilistic Menger space. Menger spaces, and of course, and probabilistic spaces are particular cases. Of Menger space, of probabilistic metric spaces. Metric spaces are particular cases of probabilistic metric spaces. Okay. Please note this example as an exercise to be discussed next time. For seniors, I have a homework. Please, homework too for seniors, researchers, senior researchers. therefore prove that the SFTM is that the induced PM space is indeed a mega spaces, approximate mega spaces. And another very, very important example, exercise 7, this not is an exercise. Because it generates many, many mega spaces. Okay? This is very, very important, exercise 7. Was not correct. the first proof, and then I corrected. It seems like for busy diameter or but it's not. In fact, this is for easy diameter for the images of images of mappings. This is a kind of busy diameter here. You would use this proposition in the stability of functional equations. It's very widely used this. The fact that this space is indeed is a generalized probably symmetric space. And this is important. Simple space generated by an metric space and a particular distribution function. And finally, may I scroll? Not yet? Just to say some of the pieces. Some books, Chang Chou and Gang, the basic. Here you can find the first results from arithmetic spaces theory, and in particularly in the fixed point theory in such spaces. Another whole book with the first results. Constantine and Stratescu, Elements of Probability Analysis and Applications, in Springer, 1989. Okay. Here, in reference 6, Olga Hajic introduced she's Dinos. A book, it's a monograph, but it is contained in the book of Hajic and Pap. This is the book of Stratescu. I said is the oldest book in fixed point theory, in probabilistic basis theory. Some papers and a monograph about Dinos, Clement, Messier, and Pack. There is my monograph where I studied some aspects of triangle inequality, but okay, this is a starting point of research. The monograph of Radu, very, very nice monograph. The book of Weiss and Sklar. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Eugen.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you,
Eugen.
So today's session is completed. So tomorrow's session will start from 10 hours. So please, when you wake up sharp
9:45.
Those who have a doubt, come here.
जिन लोगों ने अभी रजिस्ट्रेशन का साइन नहीं किया है रुक जाइए।